Starting us off at number 10, we have the evil Christmas legend, Krampus. While Krampus was made into a 2015 horror slash comedy movie, there really isn't anything funny about this legend. Krampus is the anti-Santa Claus and really undermines the holiday spirit we all know and love. Legend says that Krampus is supposed to scare the kids on the naughty list into behaving better, but it gets really dark when we take a look at how he goes about scaring them. Krampus either beats the kids with birch branches, which is already gruesome and evil enough, but he will also tie kids up in a sack and haul them off to hell. Krampus is mainly a German and Austrian tale, but he is definitely recognized in other countries who have their own versions. I don't know about you, but I'd really rather get a lump of coal under the tree than get kidnapped by Krampus.
All right, next up at number 9, we have the Momo Challenge. So this internet legend spread like wildfire throughout social media. Momo is actually this user, you guys are seeing it on your screen right now, absolutely terrifying. Well, whoever's behind this, I have no idea, but they got people to perform very dangerous acts and self-harm. Back in 2018, which isn't that long ago, this challenge went worldwide. We still don't know who Momo is. We don't know who is behind it. People like Kim Kardashian posted on her Instagram story pleading for YouTube to remove all these challenge videos. Well, legends have it that Momo is still alive.
In our number 8 spot today, we have the killer in the backseat, or the High Beams legend. This legend originated from folklorist Carlos Drake in 1968. The legend says that there is a woman who is driving and being followed by another car. She begins to panic as the person following her keeps flashing their high beams at her, they're tailgating her, and they even ram her vehicle. When she finally makes it to what she thinks is a safe place, she comes to find that the person following her was actually trying to warn her of a murderer in her back seat, and they flashed their high beams every time he tried to sit up and attack her, causing them to duck back down. If you've driven on an unlit highway before, you know how annoying people and their high beams can be. But maybe I need to take a second thought before just dismissing them.
And moving right along, in at number 7, we have the Devil's Chair. This is a very popular urban legend in Florida. Well, let me know what states that you guys are from and what is the most popular urban legends you guys have. Let me know in the comment section below. And also make sure to hit the like button because it really helps us out. All right, getting back into this, the Devil's Chair was turned into a movie. And you know what? Let me show you guys a quick trailer of that.
During the 1950s, this place was an institute for mental health care.
An asylum.
And this is where the incident supposedly took place.
Is this real life right now? It's a pretty haunted chair with a ton of dark history behind it. I'm pretty sure it's like an electric chair or some sort of torture device. People have seen ghosts in the chair and maybe the devil himself. If you sit in the chair, the devil will whisper horrible things into your ear that will change you forever. I think, you know what? Let's not test this one out. And let's quickly move on to number 6 before we get in trouble with that one. Well, let me take you guys over to the state of Missouri. What you guys are looking at right now is Zombie Road. Well, this is a real place and it's Missouri's most haunted places. It's about 2 miles long through a valley, probably a valley of death. The road is always closed up at nighttime. Yeah, for good. People have seen child ghosts and tortured souls of working men killed in the industrial accidents. I have footage from YouTube channel Ghost Hunters. Take a look at this. Okay, I mean, this looks like a road that I would never want to go on.
Coming in at number 5, we have the Vanishing Lady. Let us know in the comments if you've heard of this one before. A daughter and her mother are abroad in Paris for the World's Fair when the mother falls ill. The daughter leaves the hotel room in order to get some medicine for her mother, but when she returns, she finds that her mother has disappeared, their hotel room doesn't exist, and no one at the hotel can remember seeing either of them. Apparently, the mother had died while her daughter was out, and in an attempt to cover up any bad publicity, the hotel got rid of the body and pretended like the pair never existed. The daughter ends up getting committed to a psychiatric hospital where she spends the rest of her life. It would be so scary to know that something is true, but have everyone around you telling you the opposite. In our number four spot today, we've got The Bunny Man. While this sounds like it could be very cute, it absolutely is not. This one originated in Fairfax County, Virginia, and is basically just the story of a man dressed in a bunny suit who attacks people with an axe. The first report of the Bunny Man came on October 19th, 1970, when a man and his wife were stopping in to visit an uncle. They were sitting in their parked car across the street from the house when they saw something moving in the rearview mirror. Just a few moments later, one of the front windows was smashed. When the couple looked up, they saw a man wearing the bunny costume screaming at them. Luckily, the car was still turned on, so they were able to make a quick escape, but as they drove away, they found a hatchet on the floor of the car. A man with a hatchet is already scary enough, but there's something so disturbing about him being dressed in a bunny costume.
And just like that, number three, have you guys heard of the Candy Lady? Well, I didn't either until now. This very scary urban legend comes from Texas. The Candy Lady allegedly lures children to their doom by enticing them with candy. Well, you know what? If this woman put a Kit Kat bar down, she'd for sure lure me into wherever she wants me to go. I'm pretty easy when it comes to candy and chocolates. Well, this lady would bring goodies to kids' windowsills just before bedtime. The plan is, you know, the parents go to sleep, and when the kids start eating, yum, 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 when they start eating the candy, boom, you get snatched out your window. She will grab you. The Candy Lady would feast on these sugar high bodies. Well, pretty messed up urban legend if you guys asked me. And is it just me, or does it seem like parents might have made this one up for kids to, like, you know, scare the heck out of them? They don't eat candy before bedtime. If I heard this urban legend, I would never eat candy again. I think these parents are trying to save on, like, dental bills.
In our number two spot, we've got The Babysitter and the Man Upstairs. If you've seen the 2006 movie When a Stranger Calls, you know just how creepy this one is. The story goes that a teenager is babysitting some children for a family. She begins receiving phone calls from some sort of stalker asking her if she's checked on the sleeping children. The first call she believes is just a prank call, but when the same call keeps coming over and over, she begins to get very frightened and calls the police, who say that they will trace the next call. When they trace the next call, it is revealed that the caller is calling from inside the house, and he was calling from the phone upstairs after having murdered the children. It's safe to say, I didn't do a lot of babysitting after watching this movie.
And finally, in at number one, we have Pennywise.
We all know Pennywise from the horror movie It, but did you guys know it might have been based on a true story?
Well, the story might have been inspired by John Wayne Gacy, the man who's famously known as the Killer Clown. He was an American serial killer, a sex offender who might have killed over 33 people.
He would lure young boys into his home, and once he got them there, he would pretend he was performing a magic trick in order to handcuff them, leaving them totally defenseless. There were a few times where he even had what he called a double, where he would kill two victims in one night.
A lot of the victims were buried in his own backyard, which is absolutely insane.
This story gives me goosebumps every time.
Number 10, the Deer Do. I always find it fascinating how we can find similar breadcrumbs around the world that depict legends of vampires. The Celtic depiction of the vampire is the Deer Do, and the story behind her is heartbreaking. The Deer Do once was a breathtaking, beautiful woman who had given her love to an innocent farm boy, but her father was greedy and arranged her to marry an abusive chieftain for wealth and land. No amount of begging could save her from her fate, and unfortunately, the marriage went through. After the wedding day, the woman fell into a deep depression, not eating or drinking until her body wasted away. Her lost love visited the grave every single day, wishing her to return, but come the year anniversary of her death, it was revenge that brought her back. She went straight to her father's bed and sucked the life from him. Not yet sated, she went of course to her brutal husband and, finding him surrounded by women in lustful acts, flew into a rage and not only sucked out his soul, but drained all the blood from his body. Every year on the anniversary of her death, she rises to seduce young men before devouring their blood. So to this day, on the anniversary of her death in Waterford, people place rocks on her grave so she cannot rise from the earth. But sometimes, if the rocks aren't heavy enough, the Dirk Du escapes, seeking to sate her bloodlust. Number 9, the Dullahan. The Dullahan is a foreboding headless horseman who's set to ride during festival days. He is said to be one of the most terrifying creatures who resides in the spirit world. Some consider him the angel of death. He rides a jet black stallion, and his flowing black cape blazes behind him while he rides. But his head does not sit on his shoulders, but is held in his hand. It is said that his eyes can see for miles at night, but the most terrifying thing about him is if you see him. If you don't avert your eyes as he rides past, you may get struck by a bucket of blood, or lose sight in one of your eyes. But beware if his steed begins to slow and approach you, for if he stops before you and calls your name, your soul will be sucked from your body. His only weakness is gold, so instead of trying to outrun him, carry a piece of gold in your pocket to ward him off. You know, just because everybody has gold, I guess. Number 8, speaking of creatures you don't want to encounter at night, next up we have the Banshee. The Banshee can appear in many forms, so some say she appears as a beautiful woman in a shroud, or a headless naked hag holding a bucket of blood. But even more terrifying than her appearance is her song. The Banshee is an omen of death and is said to appear to warn of violent death, either of a loved one or for the listener. Some Banshees even do the killing themselves, while other legends say they are spirits tied to their loved ones and sing songs of care and concern for the ones about to pass. At one time in Ireland, it was considered blasphemous not to believe in Banshees, and some older generations still believe to this day. Real or superstitious? The legend of the Banshee is a haunting story of an inescapable fate. Number 7, Balor and the Evil Eye. Balor was a legendary ancient being who existed long before the Tuatha De Danann, a race of godlike people with supernatural powers. When Balor was a young man, he spied on his father and his druids as they performed a spell to lay waste to the land. Vapors from the spell infected his eye, enlarging it and granting it the power of death. Balor himself was said to be enormous, so large in fact that it took 4 men to lift his eyelid open for use. Whatever met his gaze would wither and die, including grass, trees, and even turn men to stone. But on the same day he was created, the druids prophesied he would be killed by his grandson. So, of course, he locked his daughter away. But of course, someone snuck in, had 3 babies with her, and though Balor drowned 2 of them, the 3rd snuck away and finally killed him one day in battle. Number 6, the Kelpie. Also known as the Nope Horse, this is the creature grannies warn their grandchildren about to keep them away from the water. And no, I'm not talking about the Australian dog breed. That's adorable. Kelpies are horses that linger near rivers and bodies of water that seem harmless at first, but if you try and ride them, you will stick to them and they will drag you to the depths to consume you, like a sticky horse. But if horses don't tempt you, they also can appear as beautiful women to lure you in with their feminine wiles. Or they can appear as hairy humanoids that wait in trees and leap on unsuspecting travelers and smash them. Depictions of these creatures are absolutely terrifying, and I can't even imagine what it would be like to be dragged underwater by a very sticky horse. They can also summon up sudden floods and rapids to drown unsuspecting victims. However, Kelpies do have a weak spot. If you do find them disguised as horses, if you get a hold of their bridle, it must serve you, giving you the strength and stamina of over 10 horses. Number 5. Carmen. If you're keeping track of evil witches, make sure to add this woman to your list. Carmen was an evil witch who terrorized the land along with her 4 sons, darkness, evil, and violence. Yeah. She placed a vicious blight on the crops of Ireland until the gods of Tuatha De Danann brought their magic against her. They drove her sons across the sea and imprisoned her, but were tasked with throwing a festival in her name each year, otherwise the land would be faced with a blight. Carmen reportedly died of grief in 600 BCE, and the festival is held every 3 years on August 1st. Number 4, the Fae. If you're already a fan of Irish folklore, then you may already be familiar with imps or the Fae. And the reasons why we fear them. Fairy lore, I think, is the next vampire craze. They're mysterious, immortal, powerful, and very sexy. What else could you want? But you may want to think twice before wandering into the woods hoping for some handsome fae man to take you away. Probably not a good idea. Anyone who knows the lore of the Fae will warn you not to take them lightly. They love to mess with mortals and are notoriously known for stealing babies in the dead of night to replace them with possessed changelings. Though they could sometimes be friendly, they often look for ways to trick you. So, if you do want to get on their good side, here are a few very important rules to follow. Number 1, do not call them fairy. It is an insult. Call them good neighbor, imp, elf, or sealy white. Number 2, always turn your socks inside out when going for a hike. The imps will not be able to lead you astray and make you impossibly lost. Number 3, if they offer you food, deny it. It's a sure way to become trapped in the fairy realm. But like, if that's what you want, I mean, do it, though I would expect some torment if you do, so probably don't. Number four, never lie to them. They will never lie to you, but they have a way of twisting words. But if you want respect, you gotta give respect. Number five, if you accept a gift, you must give one greater in return, but do not say thank you. It means you owe whatever they ask in return. And lastly, number six, carry iron or salt with you to protect against the darker imps. Anyways, there is a couple tips for you, but if you do come across one, don't brag about it. They hate that. Number three, the dark man. Now, I mentioned that some imps are mischievous and even dangerous, but there is one being even they fear, the dark man. He who lurks, he who stalks, the dark druid. Even whispering his name invites his attention. So let's hope I'm not in trouble here, guys. Some say he's a shadow man with malevolent powers. Others say he serves the Queen of the Sid coldly and without remorse, claiming anyone she calls for. Those he took were never heard from again. The fact that our good neighbors fear him so much is enough to say that we should too, especially considering the story of the taking of Finn's wife. The dark man fell in love with a beautiful woman who spurned his love, so of course he cursed her by turning her into a fawn. The only way she could be released was if she found her true love, and that she did. Once she entered the house of the wise Finn McCool, she was safe. For years they lived together until Finn went off to battle. When he returned home, he discovered that she'd been deceived and taken by the dark druid who appeared in his likeness. Finn never saw her again. Number two, the Avertok. Some may know Vlad the Impaler as the main inspiration for the character of Dracula, but considering Bram Stoker's Irish heritage, the origins of this famous villain may have been closer to home. The Irish king Avertok ruled between Dungiven and Garvagh and was abhorred by his people. But despite his awful reputation, his name isn't that intimidating. It's actually an old Irish name that means deaf fellow, and many believe he was also a man of small stature. Some say he was a dwarf, others say that he just lost his legs in an accident so he was shorter. He was an evil and cruel wizard, hated and feared by his clans. He was also insanely jealous and suspected his wife of having an affair. So one night he slipped out a window and tried to peer into her room to catch her in the act, but instead he slipped and fell to his death. Yay, I guess. The people relieved to see his demise buried him right away, standing upright in the ground as for his kingliness he needed to be. Sitting upright in the ground, which was tradition. But the next morning, he appeared demanding bowls of blood from his people, freshly poured from their wrists. The people begged a neighboring chieftain to save them, and he tried to kill him not once, but three times, yet still he would appear the next morning demanding blood. The chieftain sought the advice from a neighboring saint, and this time when he killed him, he buried him upside down, stabbed him in the heart with a stake from the yew tree, piled ash wood on top of him, and placed atop the grave a heavy stone slab. You can still visit the grave to this day, but locals still fear the site, and some have even had very eerie experiences. Ooh. Number one, the Slua. There is one night a year that you should fear the Slua, spirits of death who show no mercy to whoever crosses their path. The only way to dissuade them from taking your soul is if you offer up another soul in return. You may know this night as Halloween, but those who believe in Celtic folklore call it Samhain. Some say they used to be imps who became twisted and warped by dark magic. It is said they fly from the west in a dark mass, seeking souls to drag back with them into the darkness. On Samhain, fires were forbidden so as not to attract them to your door, and windows on the west side of the house were locked shut. They are also locked tight if someone in the house is ill or dying, as the Slua often delight in stealing souls before they can give their last rites. But you can also call them to you by saying their name aloud. So, like, guess I'm screwed.
Starting us off at number 10 is Route 666. What a fitting number. Also known as the Devil's Highway, Route 666 is a 200-mile north-south carriageway that goes through New Mexico, Utah, Colorado, etc. And funnily enough, the route was renamed to Route 491 back in 2003 because of the original satanic associations and the fact that so many accidents have taken place on it. Every time a fatal or non-fatal accident has happened on the road, it's always been blamed on the name of the road, not maybe someone with a DUI or anything, but the name of the road. Everyone just assumes something paranormal is definitely at play here. Many Native Americans believe skinwalkers are the reasons for all the accidents because they appear out of nowhere and so suddenly, so cars just have to swerve out of the way. Shamans even warn drivers not to continue, but then would have to be summoned to take the lives of those who did not heed his warnings. If skinwalkers aren't bad enough, even hellhounds have been noted to patrol regions of the road in packs. Witnesses have said the hounds have kept pace with the cars no matter how fast they were going. And of course, they can also shred your tires with their claws or teeth or both, and then proceed to maul you inside your car. Paranormal aside, even mechanical failures seem to be more common on this highway than others. Flat tires, overheating, breakdowns, everything apparently. There's even a haunted truck that collides with cars on purpose to run them off the road, which is just personally just not what I'm looking for on a road trip. That's just not really my vibe, personally. Coming in at number 9 is The Hitchhiker, and I'm pretty sure everyone has heard some type of variation of this one, so let's just get into it. This legend centers around some mysterious hitchhikers which we already know we shouldn't be picking up or giving a ride. A cab driver found someone dressed in all black with a hood over their face looking for a ride. He picked them up, and the person gave an address the driver wasn't familiar with, but assured him he could give him directions. They get further and further out, taking back roads and alleys, and eventually they're out of the city completely. Rattled, the driver asks if they're going the right way, to which the person says, "Don't worry, we're almost there." They end up on a road that's basically falling apart, and at this point the driver finally turns around to ask where exactly they're going, to find the back seat empty. And by the time he turns back around, he realizes he's heading straight for the edge of a cliff and plummets to his death. Now, I'm not sure whether this legend is supernatural in any way, like is a hitchhiker a real person? Are they a ghost? How did they vanish from the car like that? I'm confused. Either way, just be very wary when you're picking up hitchhikers. Actually, just don't do it. Don't do it. At number 8 we have The Waiting Car, and apparently this has happened to many people on road trips, but let's look at one family's experience in particular. Every summer this family would go on a road trip from North Texas to Mexico, and when you're on a stretch of highway in the middle of the desert, it's not really a big deal if the same car has been behind you for ages. I mean, there's not really anywhere else it can go. So at this point, the family had been in Mexico for an hour, but had a few more hours of the drive left. The user's mom suddenly goes to her dad, "Miguel, that car behind us, it's been behind us since we left Laredo." And the dad responded with what I said earlier about it not being that big of a deal. But then eventually the car behind them started getting closer, and at one point it was practically touching their rear. The other car was playing with them, it would ease off them, then blind them with their headlights, then tailgate them again, etc. And thankfully the mom saw police car up ahead and they pulled over. After telling the cop what happened, the policeman told them how people had their cars stolen on empty highways by criminals and thugs. He drove behind them for a while for safekeeping, and around 10 minutes later they saw the same car from before on the side of the road waiting for them. Filling our number 7 slot are Hell's Angels. So originally people thought this myth or legend originated sometime in the 90s in LA, but apparently it started in the early 80s in Montana with the Hell's Angels biker gang as the centerpiece. It goes like this. If you're ever driving home late and you pass a car that has its high beams on, as a courtesy gesture you would usually flash your high beams at them to let them know so they stop blinding every driver passing them. But in this instant, a car with high beams on isn't just accidental. If you flashed your high beams at these cars, that was basically you signing your own death warrant. Cars like that were usually driven by initiates for local gangs, mainly Hell's Angels, and their initiation, I guess, was for them to kill you. So next time you decide to go on a road trip, be very careful on who you signal to. Now at number 6 is the petrol pump trap. I think the thing that gives me the most anxiety while driving is running out of petrol and there being no petrol pumps within like a 10 kilometer radius of me, and I'm just like, wow, I'm gonna be stuck here forever, what do I do? But anyway, sometimes finding a petrol pump just isn't that lucky at all. There are so many legends surrounding petrol pumps and bad things happening to people at them, you'd be surprised. Apparently, gas stations are a popular place for people to get ambushed. This story in particular is about two girls who were on a road trip and decided to stop for gas at 10 p.m. They found a petrol pump that was for the most part not shady at all. It was brightly lit, looked clean, looked busy with other cars, it seemed perfectly fine. The only open pump was in the middle of the station, so the girl got out to fill the tank. As she unscrewed the gas cap, she heard a shout and then turned around to see a man with a gun and a group of people with him. She soon realized all the cars around her were empty and they were decoys, and it was actually a trap for whoever drove into it. The man started yelling at her to get onto the ground and for her friend to get out of the car, otherwise he'd shoot them or rape them or worse. Her friend sat frozen in the car, so the other girl offered to go in and talk to her and get her out. But then obviously instead of talking to her friend, she puts the car in reverse and they both managed to escape. That was just one of many stories about things like this happening, so it's definitely not even a legend but a real thing. Coming in at number 5 is Port Perry Ghost Road. Now legend has it that on this road a motorcyclist crashed at night and was killed sometime in the 1950s. 1980s. Ever since then, drivers on the road seem to see a motorcycle light in their rearview mirror. The light then catches up to the car and passes it before disappearing entirely. Other accounts say they've just seen a red light roaming the road at night, but you somehow are never able to trace its source. Shady. Just pure shady. And many TV documentaries have been made about the legend, and it's become quite a tourist attraction. However, with every legend, there are skeptics. Locals who have lived in and around the area for generations say there was no motorcycle accident around the time of the legend. Having said that, the Ontario Ghosts and Hauntings Research Society, which I didn't even know existed, maintain that there are ghost lights in the area, and a dead body was found in the area in the 60s or 70s, so even if a motorcyclist didn't die, this road really should be avoided at all costs. At number 4 is the Cult Trap. Again, variations of this legend always float around, so it's hard to pinpoint really which story was the original. But anyway, legend has it that a man was driving through a bunch of rural backroads at night because he thought it would be a shortcut compared to his usual route. At one point, the roads led him to a long road that was surrounded by crops or tall grass. Halfway down the road, they see a car, and in some stories it's on one side of the road, in others it's parked over two lanes, but in all variations, the boot and doors are always open. Clothes are strewn all over the road, and there are two bodies on the ground. Obviously, the driver's first reaction is to get out and help the people, but when they go to call the ambulance, they realize they have no service. And then things get a bit fishy. Everything just seems too accident-like, almost like it had been staged. Now, the next part has many variations. Sometimes the driver just completely avoids the scene and goes around it. Another has him seeing reflections of light on eyes in the grass by the road. But either way, as the person drives away, they see the two bodies on the ground getting on their knees, and 20 people magically emerging from the tall grass. Had the person stayed, well, we can all guess what would have become of him or her. Filling our number 3 slot is the Pavement Bigfoot. I just tried to be creative there, but there's a legend that surrounds Bray Road in the town of Elkhorn, Wisconsin. Even the name of the town sounds Lord of the Rings-esque. But anyway, to any person, Bray Road looks pretty, peaceful, and normal, surrounded by crops and greenery. It looks as good as any road, really. False. By night, the Beast of Bray is said to haunt a certain part of Bray Road. Eyewitness reports have varied throughout time, but the beast is meant to have Bigfoot-like proportions, and many have speculated that it's actually in fact a werewolf. But honestly, if you're giving me a choice between running into Bigfoot on my road trip or running into a werewolf, I would honestly choose none and just cancel my trip. Is that not the obvious choice here? I'm not about to get stuck in the middle of nowhere in Wisconsin with the Beast of Bray Road ready to attack me in the sidelines. That's just a hard no from me, and it should be a hard know from you too. Now at number 2 is Route 2A. Now Route 2A is a dangerous route located in Haynesville, Maine. Now this one is known for the high number of accidents that happen there, the bad driving conditions, and the whole host of spirits that have been seen there over the past few years. Or decades, really. Great. Everything that makes a road not drivable. You know a road is problematic when there's even a song about it called A Tombstone Every Mile. Need I say more? Whilst many people have died in car accidents there, there's also an urban legend surrounding the road. Many people have seen a woman shouting at drivers passing by and saying how her husband is trapped in their car and that they need help. But if you do end up stopping for her, she just disappears. The story goes that the husband got stuck in there and died of carbon monoxide poisoning, and the wife either froze to death outside waiting for help, or she was hit by a car. And hence, they have some unfinished business with the area. Other accounts have said they've seen a little girl on the side of the road that was killed by a truck years ago. Either way, let's just not. And finally, at number 1 is Shades of Death Road. Honestly, this one can be done in 5 seconds because all I have to say is look at the name of the road, have one brain cell, don't travel on it. The end. But no, seriously, Shades of Death Road, real name by the way, is a quiet country lane located in Warren County, New Jersey, and the legends surrounding this road are plentiful. The road runs alongside an old haunted lake bed which has pillars of mist rising from it, and no one knows how that's caused, but it's just there. Apparently, early settlers killed native Indians and threw them into the lake, and their unhappy souls lived on to haunt the lake and the road. Some say they've seen the dead walk alongside the road amidst the mist. People in the area say the site used to be the location of so many deaths, they thought it was cursed. Another story was that the original people who lived in the area were a band of squatters, vile men who used to fight each other for women, and those fights would result in someone always dying. As their reputation grew, the area started being called Shades of Death. Another story was that it was actually called the Shades originally because of the low-hanging trees that formed a canopy which made it easier for murders to happen there and stay unsolved. Either way, whichever story you believe, this road is one you should definitely try to avoid for a plethora of reasons, and I just told you all of them.